The first speaker for today is Riccardo Giusti from the Department of Control and Computer Engineering. He will give a speech entitled Synchromodal Logistics, Enabling Technologies and Related Projects. Riccardo is a PhD student in the Department of Control and Computer Engineering at Politecnico Torino, working in the field of operations research. Before starting his PhD program, he worked as a research fellow in a Horizon 2020 European research project called the Synchronet, developing a simulation tool to optimize freight itineraries on a graph, representing a synchromodal logistic network. Working on this project motivated him to investigate modern paradigms for long-haul transportation, especially synchromodal logistics. His research mainly focuses on designing mathematical models and implementing solution methods for synchromodal logistics, requiring decisions on different planning levels, from long-term strategic decisions to real-time replanning ones. Please, Riccardo, you can start your presentation.
Thanks for your introduction. So, as it was said, today I will talk about synchromodal logistics and also about the projects that we developed during this year of research. So first things, I wanted to give you an overview of the contest. So we are talking about long-haul freight transportation, and we are talking about the paradigm of synchromodal logistics. So what is long-haul freight transportation? Basically, it's the movement of goods over long distances. You can think, for example, shipping around Europe or even around the world since we are experiencing globalization since a few years. And mainly it regards the movement of goods between at least cities. So the long haul can be intended also as a long distance transportation. Usually the main transportation modes that are used to perform the shipments are the one that you can see. So trains, trucks, river barges, ships. And it's not so common, but at least it needs to be mentioned. Also airplane shipments are performed, but usually the first four transportation modes are the most common. So to improve the quality of long-haul transportation during the year, new strategies and paradigms were coined to improve the efficiency of the networks. So we have multimodal transportation that, let's say, was the first paradigm that was coined, and involve the shipments by using more than a mode of transportation. So for instance, imagine you have to ship a container, you don't just ship that by truck or by train, but you ship that by truck, and then you move the container to a train, and then maybe you move it to a ship, depending on where it needs to go. But the main purpose of multimodality is to use more mode of transportation to perform a shipment. And then we move to intermodal transportation that try to integrate more this movement of goods between modes. And so for instance, we're starting to develop unit load. And with unit load, we mean some type of container, pallets or other things that contains goods that can be easily moved from a mode of transportation to another. Then there were two different focuses, let's say, starting from intermodal transportation, one that focuses more on the sustainability of the operation that it's called combined transportation. And then we have the co-modal transportation that focuses more on the efficiency, so spend less. Then, let's say, all these characteristics are inherit from synchromodality that, beside that, try to introduce a more sophisticated way to perform the operation. So there are some requirements that are the real-time information sharing between the stakeholders that allow for each stakeholders to know what is going on in the relevant operation to them. And also that requires a stronger cooperation and coordination that goes, let's say, usually we have a vertical cooperation. So usually stakeholders with different businesses are cooperating, but here we need also an horizontal cooperation. So between stakeholders with similar businesses, and then both stakeholders and customers should be more flexible, both in developing the operation and also in requesting how the shipment should be performed. And that will allow to have the possibility to synchronize the operations to have more gain on doing that. So just to have a small recap, after let's say studying a bit what we found in literature about synchromodality, we came out with this definition that summarizes some of the characteristics, and moreover, it showed the focus that is to perform to have an efficient in terms of cost and more reliable in terms of having services that ensure you the timing that were promised, and also the flexibility to adjust to react to disruption, and more sustainable service, so less emissions. And to doing that, a major requirement is to use new and innovative technologies. By doing that, become possible to use new procedures. And so, for instance, we can have a modal booking that guarantees to a customer that his shipments are performed, and he doesn't need to care too much about the routing, the type of modes that are using. And we have also replanning. So during the operation, there is the possibility that something is planned again because something was, some disruptive event was detected. And so it needs to be replanned. And so to implement synchromodality, we found some critical success factors. And there are things going from, let's say, a legal, political perspective, something more behavioral of the stakeholders involved. Other instead are more related to technologies. And in fact, we are more interested to the critical success factor that is regarding ECT and ITS technologies. So one thing that we did was trying to summarize the enabling technologies that are required to implement synchromodality. And we did that by dividing them in different categories. So we have the traceability, that is, let's say, the capacity of being able to track the events, how the operation are performed, and so having, let's say, the real-time information needed to do everything else. Then we required intelligent systems, both, let's say, from can be intelligent assistant that help decision maker to take decision, or even automatic machinery that help to perform the operations with a better timing. And also we require data analytics because we need more data to be analyzed, because if everything is tracked, there are data coming from object, vehicles, and everything. So that it's something that is required. And also optimization, so you're trying to improve the decisions that are taken and the utilization of the resources. And we also need simulation to try to understand how the logistics system is working, and last, integration platforms that should provide a way to perform businesses, better businesses between the stakeholders, and also have the technology tools to perform their businesses. And so what we did next was to try to understand which enabling technologies could help also to succeed in dealing with the other critical success factors. And since we work in the field of optimization, we mainly focus on the enabling technologies regarding optimization, but also we did something regarding simulation and integration platform. We will then see those projects. just to, let's say, show you the current situation of the logistic interaction between stakeholders. Basically, now they are interacting with each other directly, and there are different levels, for instance, of logistics services that are offered. For instance, carriers offer a single transportation services with a mode between the routes, while 3PLs and 4PLs are logistics service providers that offer more complex services that sometimes also reach the supply chain management level. And instead, synchromodality would need a more intelligent communication system that offer to stakeholders to have access to services designed specifically for them that use the enabling technologies to provide those tools. So the first project I would like to talk about regards operational planning. And in operational planning, usually we are required to take decisions that affect the immediate operation that we need to do. So for instance, assign some containers to the vehicles that will need to transport them. And right now we are doing a project with the University of Delft. It's still ongoing, and it aims to implement a simulation optimization approach on which we are simulating the logistic, the supply chain and the events that are happening to that. And instead, the optimization part should take the decision on which vehicles are shipping which goods. And if something happens in real time, some replanning procedures can be used. For instance, we can reroute the vehicles or the shipment through different itineraries, or we can reschedule them using different mode of transportation, or even adjusting the speed of the vehicles. So because, for instance, slowing down the ships and avoiding to arrive too early in a port that is congested help to avoid some emissions, because a ship that moving at less speed can have really, really better performance in terms of emission. And we would like to study also something related to the different type of demand that can happen, because the demand maybe can be known completely in advance, or in some case, depending on the business, can be discovered during the operation. For instance, things about Amazon that have continuously ordered from its customers. And also regarding the disruptions that can affect our network, we would like to study both endogenous and exogenous disruptions. That basically mean endogenous are the one that depend from us, while exogenous depends from other stakeholders that are not in our logistic networks. And also we would like to study both in case of business as usual disruption, like lateness in performing operation, or even catastrophic events like vehicle disruptions, unavailable routes, or other things. Then another project that we are working about regards strategic and tactical planning that usually involve long-term decisions that require usually huge investments and it's related to acquiring vehicles, making contracts, and other stuff like that. And we are doing a project with the University of Montreal regarding location transshipment problem. And basically, a transshipment operation, it's the movement of goods from one mode to another. So for instance, from the train that you are seeing here to the trucks and so on. While the location consists in deciding which terminal we want to locate. So the facility to do the transshipment that we want to use for our business. So regarding this problem, we have already published something, and we were performing a project that was using the stochastic programming approach. That basically it's a way to take into account uncertainty And we decided to take in account our uncertainty on the handling capacity in the transshipment facilities. So we don't know exactly how much capacity will be available at the time of the operation and on the utility that we gain from using that facilities. To try to explain it as easy as possible, you develop a mathematical model with more stage decision. In our case, we had two, because you have to take the decision of locating the facilities long time before. So when the uncertainty is, when some information is still uncertain, and then you have to take other decisions that are how to ship things among your network that you need to take when those things are already new. And so by defining a probability distribution for the uncertainty and deriving some scenarios through a test that is called stability analysis, you can understand how many scenarios you need to have a good approximation of the uncertainty, and then you can perform other type of tests. One, it's more regarding an economical analysis of some stochastic programming indicators that can give you some indication on how addressing uncertainty is important in monetary terms. And for instance, also how being able to forecast the uncertainty can be helpful, and also give you some indication about the composition of the deterministic solution. If from the deterministic solution, we can have a stochastic solution that, that is better. And lastly, we develop a solution method based on called progressive edging that basically solve each scenario case one by one, and then try to converge the first stage decision to a single decision. And so we can make a comparison of the computational performance against some commercial solvers. Then the last project I would like to talk about, it's Synchronet, that was an Horizon 2020 project. And we did something that is related also to making a common platform to integrate different tools. In the project, there were involved different partners, both from academic and industrial. And so our main role was to implement the modules that you see in greens that are basically a simulator and an optimization tool that was aiming to optimize the routing of the shipments, and could work both in a strategic tactical setting and also in a real-time settings. The platform was working in different models. As you can see, there are different models integrating with each other. And so, for instance, the real-time module developed from another company was communicating with our model to try to find in real time some alternative routes to replan some shipments. So I will give you a basic overview of what we developed. We make a search engine that was based on a multi-objective optimization on emission length and time. And it was possible to set some search options, so some basic like departure, arrival times, nodes. Some the user can decide which transportation modes to use, or if you want to ban or force some routes or some nodes. And it's possible also to decide multi-destination, more than a destination, and more containers for shipments. And also it's possible to configure the simulator to include the specific cost that the user known, and also to adding or updating some routes and nodes, because we were able to generate automatically some of them, but the user can also generate its own. And then this is an example of a summary. So you have information about the transportation mode. The column in colored column are our key performance indicators that can be also weighted depending on the user. And so, for instance, a user can give more importance to a mission and the results will change. And you have also other information making a summary of each itineraries. Then if you click on one itineraries, you can have exactly the information on everything regarding the specific leg of the itinerary, also regarding the boarding time, alighting time, and so on. And then the tools was tested by our industrial partners that make some tests on like number one, it was focusing on the northwest of Europe to try to understand if it was more convenient to avoid the United Kingdom after Brexit, because from Ireland they were shipping through United Kingdom, but with Brexit some problem could happen. And there was also test two, that was the pan-European demonstrator in the Greece areas and the Balkans. And you can see how it looks to have more containers shipped with different routes. And the last one, number three, show a shipment from China that then have more than a destination. So here you have also some reference about what we already published on our research. And I don't have time to explain all the details, but if you're interested, you can have a look at that, or you can contact me by mail and I can give you more information on all the specific project. So thanks for your for the attention.
Thank you, Riccardo. We have a few questions for you.
Okay.
Let's see. This is the first. How are the critical success factors prioritized among themselves?
Okay. Actually, I think that one, I can go back to the critical success factors. Probably the awareness and mental shift. I think it's something very important, because the first things that you need to do is to convince the people that are working in logistic to make this transition to a more collaborative system, and to show them how they can have a more efficient, sustainable way of performing their businesses. But I also believe that ECT, ITS technologies, maybe I'm talking about that because I'm working basically on that, but are very important, because with them, as I've shown you before, we can try to overcome also the other critical success factor. I didn't have time to talk specifically about that, but as you can see, to create, for instance, awareness about the importance of synchromodality, you can use some data analytics or some simulation. In the Netherlands, they were also developing some games. So they were making some people from industry playing some games regarding synchromodality. And they were making, let's say, a comparison without operating with the intermodality and then synchromodality in, let's say, a safe area that is a game. So there are really a lot of things that can be done to try to overcome all the critical success factor. But I believe probably the most important are these two.
Okay, so this I guess this is kind of an invitation to new researchers to join you and help in your work.
Actually, as you see, both in technology, there are something that I'm not expert about, like intelligent system, data analytics, traceability, and for sure it requires some people to work about, but also in other fields require some expert to work on that. For instance, I think I am not able to work on the legal and political framework to allow synchromodality, but there are for sure more people that are expert in that field and can help. So there is basically work for everyone. I didn't say maybe that before, but this paradigm was coined only 10 years ago, and it started to be implemented mainly in the Netherlands. So it needs also to be exported to other countries and implemented, I would say everywhere, but at least in other places. So an effort from different field experts is required for sure.
I see, I see. Since we took too long, yes. I guess I will select. No, no, it's fine, it's fine. I hope the viewers are enjoying. I will select just one other question. Okay. Recently, blockchain technology has been associated to the management of logistics operations. In your opinion, is it actually valuable as an enabling technology in this context, or is it only a buzzword?
Okay, I haven't talked here about blockchain, but in the paper we wrote a paper about an overview of synchromodality when we talk about these enabling technologies, and we go, of course, more in details. And regarding the integration platforms, we were thinking also to use some that would be useful to use some blockchain strategy, because it seems that it can give maybe more a sense of safety to the people working there, that if their data are elaborated through blockchains, can be more safe. And also with another aspect, because blockchain sometimes was associated with the smart contracts, that are basically the contracts that have some specific rule that makes something happen. For instance, you can make a contract that is a digital contract that if you are late in performing the shipment that you were supposed to do, let's say in 2 days, and you need 3 days, you automatically get fined and the money get collected. And so if you want to implement some flexible mechanism, because flexibility means also that you don't stay stick to the schedule, but you have policy on what to do when something wrong happens. And so also from a legal perspective, you should have some policy related to these smart contracts. And so, of course, blockchain, smart contracts, and all the things related to them can be useful in the implementation of synchromodality.
So I guess this this tells that there are very practical advantages in use in applying blockchain and the related technology.
Yes, yes, of course.
Okay. Thank you, Riccardo.
Also, well, thanks
for
to you.
This dynamic Q&A.